Hello everyone, this is Rupesh. Today I will be discussing about determining absolute and relative configuration in Unit 2 of Paper 402, that is Stereochemistry and Retrosynthetic Analysis. Absolute configuration. The absolute configuration at a chiral center in a molecule is a time independent and unambiguous symbolic description of a spatial arrangement of groups or sometimes ligands bonded to the chiral center. See, this is the chiral center here, and A, B, D, E are the groups or ligands attached to the chiral center, and these 1 and 2 are enantiomers. The chiral centers 1 and 2 bear the same ligands, that is ABDE. However, 1 and 2 are not superimposable on each other, meaning that the arrangement of ligands around the chiral center in 1 and 2 is different. That is, these two are a mirror image of each other. That is, 1 and 2 are mirror images of each other, meaning that the arrangement of ligands around the chiral center in 1 is the exact opposite of that in 2. Chiral centers in 1 and 2 are said to have an opposite absolute configuration. This is an enantiomer. Enantiomers are chiral molecules that are mirror images of one another. Furthermore, the molecules are non-superimposable on each other, as I said. Hence, it has these two structures, that is 1 and 2, have opposite absolute configurations. According to R&S convention, if the absolute configuration at chiral center in 1 is R, that at the chiral center in 2 is S, or vice versa. That is, if 1 is R, then definitely that 2 will be S. Or else, if 1 is S, then 2 will be R. Coming to relative configuration. The relative configuration is the experimentally determined relationship between two enantiomers. Even though we may not know the absolute configuration, the sign of a rotation of plane polarized light by an enantiomer, that is towards the right or towards the right, towards left, that is either dextro or levo, is not easily related to its configuration. This is true even for substances with very similar structures. Thus, given lactic acid, this is the formula of lactic acid with a specific rotation plus 3.82 degree, and a methyl lactate, that is the derivative of a lactic acid which has a specific rotation of minus 8.25 degree. We cannot tell from the rotation alone whether the acid and ester have the same or a different arrangement of groups about the chiral center. Their relative configurations have to be obtained by other means. If we convert plus lactic acid into its methyl ester, that is after methylation of lactic acid, we get methylation. We can be reasonably certain that the ester will be related in configuration to the acid, because esterification should not affect the configuration about the chiral carbon atom. That is, while doing esterification, the reaction should not affect the chiral center. It happens that the methyl ester so obtained is levorotatory. So we know that plus lactic acid and minus methyl lactate have the same relative configuration at the asymmetric carbon. Even if they possess opposite signs of optical rotation, however, we still do not know the absolute configuration. That is, we are unable to tell which of the two opposite configurations of lactic acid, that is 2A or 2B, corresponds to dextro plus acid, and which to the levo or acid. That is, if 2A is plus or minus, we can't tell whether it is 2A is plus or minus and 2B is plus or minus. And this is the structure of the methyl lactate. So there are so many varieties of methods to determine the absolute as well as relative configuration. One such method is the chemical correlation of configuration. In that, the first method is methods without involving the chiral center. The normal practice is to carry out a series of chemical transformation on a compound of known absolute configuration. That is, we have to carry out this as many as possible reactions on a compound which we know the absolute configuration. Such example, we have took a tartaric acid without affecting the chiral center. The new compounds thus obtained after doing many transformations, after doing many reactions, we get a new products that will have their configurations corresponding to the old one. A few examples are given in this figure. This figure shows the configuration of malic acid, isocerin, glyceraldehyde and lactic acid. As I said, we have taken the example of tartaric acid. Tartaric acid on reaction with methanol in acid, that is methylation, all acid groups get methylated, and on acetylation, only one hydroxy group gets acetylated. Either this or this, any one of this, both gives the same molecule. This on further chlorination and in the next step reduction, we get a malic acid. These boxed ones are very important. That is, we can now know the configuration of an malic acid using tartaric acid. Now this malic acid can be converted to this structure, an amide. This on reacting with sodium hypobromide, we get an isocerin. So now we know the configuration of isocerin also from the older one. That is, I have told you here, the new compounds thus obtained will have their configuration corresponding to the old one. See, the configurations which is same as that of the old one. This isocerin on reaction with nitrosyl bromide, we get the corresponding bromide. This on reduction with sodium or mercury, we get an lactic acid. This on so many transformations, this on many set of chemical reactions, we get a plus 2-butanol. That is, I have given the steps here. The lactic acid is converted to an alcohol, that is CH2OH, and then CH2OH is converted to CH2Br. By brominating it, this CH2Br is converted to CH2CN by cyanating, that is by reacting with KCN. This CH2CN on reduction using LAH, we get this corresponding primary amine, and then further it is converted to a primary alcohol, and then it is converted to iodo by Mitsunobu reaction, and this iodo is reduced using reducing agents to corresponding alkyl group. That is, we get 2-butanol. And again, further, this plus glyceraldehyde is converted to glyceric acid. We get the opposite configuration, that is on oxidation. Whereas even the isocerin on reacting with HNO2, we get an glyceric acid. Hence, from tartaric acid, From the known absolute configuration, we get an corresponding new compounds with their configurations corresponding to the older one. So from this from the tartaric acid, we came to know the configuration of malic acid, isoserine and glyceraldehyde. Coming to the next example, that is configuration correlation of some amino acids and amines. That is, this is an serine, that is minus serine, that is an levorotatory. This serine on chlorination using PCl5, it get chlorinated at the side chains of the serine. This on reduction, we get an plus alanine, that is a dextrorotatory. See, these are all the experimentally proved compounds, proved methods. And this amine, that is a chlorinated compound and reaction with barium thiohydroxide, we get a corresponding cysteine, which is a levorotatory. And again, this plus serine, which is dextrorotatory on chlorination, we get the corresponding chloro compound. This on ammonolysis using ammonia, we get the corresponding amine, that is primary amine. And again, levorotatory aspartic acid, that is minus aspartic acid, can be converted to the corresponding amide. This on reacting with the sodium hypobromide, we get the corresponding primary amine. And also, the dextrorotatory, that is the plus aspartic acid, can be converted to an protected aspartic acid, whereas even tyrosine can also be converted to the protected aspartic acid by reacting with benzyl chloride and further reacting with the KMnO4, that is oxidizing. Whereas even phenylethylamine can also be converted to an alanine using several steps, as well as the final step of oxidation, we get an plus alanine. Therefore, starting from serine, we get the so many common, we came to know the configuration of the so many amino acids such as cysteine as well as alanine. Whereas from plus serine, we came to know the aspartic acid, or vice versa, from aspartic acid we know the configuration of the serine, whereas from plus aspartic acid we know the configuration of the tyrosine. Now coming to the next example, that is configurations of beta methoxy adipic acid and steroids. This is the malic acid on methylation, two carboxylic acids get methylated, and on ammonolysis, that is reacting with ammonia, we get the corresponding amide. This on reduction using LAH, we get the salt, that is primary amine salt. Whereas this will get a positive configuration, that is from negative malic acid, we get a positive configuration, that is from levorotatory to dextrorotatory. Whereas from beta methoxy adipic acid on chlorination, as well as subsequent reacting with sodium azide, we get the corresponding acid azides. This on reacting with HCl and under reflux condition, we get the positive corresponding primary amine salts. Hence from malic acid, we came to know the configuration of beta methoxy adipic acid. Here we are just correlating with the known absolute configurations and finding the configuration of the unknown molecule. Coming to the next important one, that is chemical correlation involving diastereomers. In the previous one, we studied chemical correlation without involving the chiral centers. Here we are going to study chemical correlation involving diastereomers. In the previous method, the nature of the atoms next to the chiral center must remain constant, and very often at least a pair of ligands of the two related chiral centers are same, as in glyceraldehyde and tartaric acid, which we studied in the previous method. Here, this method was stated by Frydenberg, which is free from this shortcomings, that is free from the previous one, and is applicable to the molecules of such type, which is common in many natural products as well as in terpenoid chemistry. The principle elegantly explained by Ellil and group devolves on the establishment of relative configuration of a particular chiral center in a molecule, that is, which is a diastereomer containing at least one more chiral center, the configuration of which is known. That is, diastereomer in the sense which have a molecule which contains more than one chiral center. And this is the example which we have taken. This shows the Frydenberg's method of chemical correlation, that is, using the known absolute configuration of a molecule, we are finding the configuration of the other natural products as well as terpenoids. And this is the shikimic acid, and this is dehydroshikimic acid. The principle is illustrated by dehydroshikimic acid obtained from shikimic acid whose configuration at C3, C4, C5 is known by conversion into 1,4-lactone. This is 1,4-lactone, and this is dihydroshikimic acid. This dihydroshikimic acid is then degraded through a series of standard reactions into plus 3 carboxy adipic acid. That is, this on series of standard reaction, it is converted to 3 carboxy adipic acid, which must thus have a R configuration. This is converted into S3-methylhexane. This is 3-methylhexane. The configuration of a number of compounds such as, this is 2-methylbutanol, this is methyl butyric acid, and 3-methyl adipic acid, this is 3-methyl adipic acid. You can see methyl is at the third position, so this is 3-methyl adipic acid, can in turn be correlated with that of 3-methylhexane. That is, it can be correlated with that of 3-methylhexane through appropriate chemical transformation. That is, this can be converted to this using appropriate chemical transformations. This 3-methyl adipic acid is obtained as a degraded product from the 3-methyl cyclohexanone. That is, this 3-methyl cyclohexanone on degradation, we get the corresponding 3-methyl adipic acid. And this is obtained, this 3-methyl cyclohexanone is obtained from the terpenoid, which is called an polygon, through a retroaldol reaction. That is, this polygon on retroaldol reaction, we get an 3-methyl cyclohexanone, and this on degradation we get the corresponding 3-methyl adipic acid. Hence, from shikimic acids we came to know the configurations of the many natural products and terpenoids. Coming to the next method, now the chemical transformation involving the chiral center. Very often, a reaction is carried out at a chiral center with predictable stereochemistry, such as configurational inversion in SN2 reactions and retention of configuration in SN1 reactions or on nucleophilic substitutions involving neighboring group participation. In such cases, where the steric course of the reaction is known with certainty, the configuration of the product can be correlated with that of the substrate and vice versa. That is, the configuration of the product can be correlated with that of substrate, or else the configuration of substrate can also be correlated with that of the product. That is, either using this substrate we can find the configuration of the product, or else using product we can correlate and find the configuration of the substrate. Following are the few examples. This is a case A. In case A is an example of an Walden inversion. That is, it is an example of an SN2 reaction. This is a case A, where this phenyl ethyl chloride is treated with sodium azide. This is an azide, sodium azide. We get the corresponding azide. This on reduction with H2 platinum, we get the corresponding amine, which is phenyl ethyl amine. Coming to cases B and C, that is, this is the reaction B and reaction C. These are the examples of migration of chiral groupings with retained configuration. That is, you can see the migration of the groups. The groups are converted to the other functional groups with retaining the configuration. That is, you can see S is retained here. Even in C, the S is retained here. And coming to case D is an example of stereoselective Simmons-Smith cyclopropylation. In this example, the configuration of 3-methyl cyclohexanone is known. That is, we know the configuration of the 3-methyl cyclohexanone, which settles the configuration of the cyclohexanone, which is R. That is, as I said you, using product we know the configuration of the substrate. Now, this is called a Simmons-Smith cyclopropylation reaction. That is, this is called Simmons-Smith reagent. Coming to the next method to determine the absolute and relative configuration, that is, methods based on comparison of optical rotation. In that, the first rule is distance rule. A number of empirical rules for configurational assignment based on optical rotation have been enunciated, which have been found to be very useful. So the statement is, the statement of distance rule or rule of distance, according to, states that the optical activity of a compound increases as a function of the decrease of the distance of the inactive part of the molecule from its asymmetric center. That is, the optical rotation of a compound is primarily determined by the arrangement of atoms and groups in the immediate vicinity of the chiral center. Therefore, if two compounds have a similarly constituted chiral centers but differ in the structure at a point distant from the chiral center, they very often show optical rotation of the same sign and even of the same magnitude if they have identical configuration. Thus, in a homologous fatty acid series with an alpha methyl group, there is an example which has an alpha methyl group here of identical configuration. The optical rotations have the same sign for all values of n, and their molecular rotations tend to approach a constant value of around 28 degree as the chain length increases. The rotation gradually decreases as the methyl group shifts nearer to the center of the chain. A generalization has been made on the basis of a distance rule, which states that the secondary alcohols, this is the secondary alcohol in structure A, and alpha hydroxycarboxylic acids, this is alpha hydroxycarboxylic acid in structure B, shows dextrorotatory and levorotatory. That is, secondary alcohol in structure A shows dextrorotatory, whereas alpha hydroxycarboxylic acid in structure B shows levorotatory. Coming to the next rule, rule of shift or displacement rule. This rule was stated by Freudenberg in 1923. The rule of shift works on a very similar principle as described above. It states that if two similarly constituted chiral molecules such as plus lactic acid and plus alanine are converted into a series of analogous derivatives such as acetates, benzoates, amides, ethers, etc., each change would produce an appreciable but comparable shift of optical rotation in same direction. The method is illustrated with the work of Freudenberg, in which the configuration of the lactic acid and alanine is correlated. That is, this lactic acid on converting to its derivatives such as acetates, benzoates and amides, and we come to know the configuration of the absolute or relative configuration of the corresponding products, and there will be a shift in the optical rotation in the same direction. That is, that if it is a dextrolactic acid, then the optical rotation will change, optical rotation will not change, but shift will be there, that is plus or minus 10 or 15 will be there, but it won't change to the levorotatory. Even the product will form, that is acetates and benzoates, amides, ethers will have the same dextrorotatory. Coming to the rule of optical superposition, the rule of optical superposition was first stated by Van't Hoff in 1894. This rule operates on the basic assumption that if a molecule contains more than one chiral center, that is a diastereomer, one center, the overall optical rotation may be considered as the algebraic sum of the contribution of each individual chiral center. That is, as I said, it is a diastereomer. That is, if a molecule contains more than one chiral center, which shows that it is a diastereomer, then the optical rotation is considered as the algebraic sum of the those two chiral centers. A more recent version of the rule by Mayo states that like functional groups in like surroundings make like contributions to optical rotation. That is, a addition of a optical rotation of at the two chiral centers. This rule is applied for the successful determination of the relative configuration of C1 in aldoses. This is the C1, it is also called as anomeric carbon. He proceeded with the assumption that in the D aldoses, the alpha anomers have the higher dextrorotation. That is, he assumed that the alpha anomers, this is an alpha anomer, have the higher dextrorotatory or else lower levorotation than the beta anomers. And in the L aldoses, the alpha anomers have the higher levorotation or else lower dextrorotation. You can see this is D aldoses, whereas this is L anomers. The structures of the four isomers that is alpha d, alpha L and beta L of aldohexoses are shown below. And these are the chair forms of the aldohexoses, and these are the fissure projections. The optical rotation of a sugar or its derivatives is regarded as a sum of the two quantities. That is, as I said you before, it's an algebraic sum. One due to the C1 center and the other due to the rest of the molecule. That is, one it is due to the C1 center and other the rest of the molecule. The dotted line, there is a dotted line, divides the molecule into the two specified segments. The contributions are plus A and minus A for C1 and plus B and minus B for the rest of the molecule. That is, you can see this carbon is named as, contribution of this carbon is plus A and minus A, whereas the contribution of the rest of the molecule, this is the rest of the molecule, is named as plus B and minus B. That is, plus for right-handed system and minus for left-handed disposition of 1-OR and 1,5-oxide ring in the fissure projections. This is 1-OR and this is 1,5-oxide ring in the fissure projection. The two rules known as Hudson's isorotation rules are now formulated as follows. For a pair of alpha and beta anomers, these are the pair of alpha and beta anomers, the sum of the molecular rotations will be approximately constant and will be the characteristics of a particular sugar or its derivatives. It will be independent of HC1OR, that is, it is independent of this one, this moiety. Coming to the second rule, the difference of molecular rotations of an anomeric pair, that is alpha and beta, will also be another constant which will be characteristic of an anomeric center, but it is the independent of the rest of the molecule. This is the independent of the rest of the molecule. Coming to the next method, method based on molecular rotation difference. The principle of the method is the same as that of the previous one, that is optical superposition. The rule has been developed by Barton and Klein in 1948 from a large number of data available in the steroid field. According to this rule, the molecular rotation of a steroid or a polyterpenoid may be described as the sum of the contribution made by the parent hydrocarbon. For example, cholestain, androstain, pregnen or the steroids, and the contribution made by any other functional group or groups present in the molecule. The parent hydrocarbons such as cholestain, androstain and pregnen have molecular rotation values of plus 91 degree, plus 5 degree and plus 52 degree respectively in the phi alpha series, and plus 91 degree and plus 11 degree and plus 58 degree respectively in the phi beta series. The shift in the molecular rotation due to a substituent is known as delta value, which depends on the position and the orientation of the substituent. That is, you can see there is a difference in the molecular rotation, that is a shift in the molecular rotation due to a substituent. You can see compared to phi alpha, 6 degrees are more in phi beta. So this difference, this shift in molecular rotation due to a substituent is called delta value. The delta values for 6 alpha hydroxy and 6 beta hydroxy are 55 degree and minus 50 degree respectively, which means that 6 alpha hydrocholesterol. This is the structure of a 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You can see 6 hydroxy. It may be 6 alpha or beta. Would have molecular rotations, that is 91 plus 55 degree and 91 plus minus 50 degree. That is, in you can see the 5 alpha series we got 91 degree, whereas the delta value for 6 alpha is 55. So 91 plus 55, whereas for the beta isomer you get a 91 minus 50 degree, which is approximately a correct value according to the experiment. An application of this rule is illustrated by the determination of a position of the double bond in cholestein formed by dehydrohalogenation of 3-chlorocholestein. That is, this rule is applied to determine the position of the double bond. So the double bond could be either between C2 and C3, you can see here, or between C3 and C4. The molecular rotation of the actual product according to experiment, we got plus 248 degree, which conforms to that of the 2-3-cholestein. That is, experimental we got 248 degree, calculated 243, which is perfectly matching. Whereas you can see in 3, the double bonds between C3 and C4, it doesn't matching to any of this molecule, any of this values. Hence the molecular rotation which conforms to the to that of 2-3-cholestein. So using this rule, you can determine the position of the double bond in any of the natural products or terpenoid chemistry. Coming to the next rule, which is a Mill's rule. Mill examined the rotations of a few epimeric pairs of terpenoid and steroidal allyl alcohols of known configuration and came out with a set of rules which as follows. The more levorotatory epimer, that is the more gel, the more levorotatory epimer as the configuration as that of A, this is the configuration of A, corresponding to that of an S glyceraldehyde. That is the configuration of A is corresponding to that of the S glyceraldehyde. And the more dextrorotatory one as the opposite configuration, that is B, corresponding to that of the R glyceraldehyde. See, here we are comparing to the glyceraldehyde which we know the configuration already. The difference in rotations between the epimers is usually high and is increased by esterification. Examples in the steroid field are given by 3 beta hydroxycholestein. That is, this is, you can see here, 3 beta hydroxycholestein, and this is 3 alpha hydroxycholestein, has which have the molecular rotations of 170 degree and 467 degree respectively. The former is configurationally related to S glyceraldehyde. That is, this molecule is related to an S glyceraldehyde, whereas this alpha hydroxycholestein is related to an R glyceraldehyde. Hence the configurations of the natural products are also been known. Coming to the next method of quasi-racemate. The two structurally similar chiral molecules of opposite configuration, that is 82 atom, sometimes form quasi-racemic compounds which can be easily characterized by their mixed melting point diagram. This provides a method of configurational correlation of two species which may not be chemically transformed into each other. The method is very simple and the least time consuming, but in order to succeed requires some conditions to be fulfilled. The compounds to be compared should be chemically very similar. They must not be too small and are usually polar. Both enantiomers of at least one of the compounds, that is A and B, must be available so that one can check whether plus A and plus B form a quasi-racemic compound and plus A and minus B form a simple mixture or the reverse. The method is not applicable if both the combinations form molecular compounds or if both form a simple mixture. A classical correlation achieved by this method is between malic acid and methyl succinic acid. They do not form quasi-racemic compounds by themselves.